Then, of course, there was always the omnipresent... Oh!
I read that they were going to go into the studio and make an album. And I was a bit peeved because I thought, well, I wonder why they hadn't asked me, because I was interested in doing it.
I mean, Martin at the time was a pretty renowned producer from Purple, Sabbath, many other things.
I mean, Martin would have produced the first album, really, if we'd have known that he was available. We didn't approach him because we thought he was unapproachable, you know, at that point, you know. We thought he was this big star producer and he wouldn't be interested in a small band like us.
Oh, right. He wanted me to do the album and I wanted to do the album, but we never actually got together.
They'd worked with Martin Birch, the producer, on Killers, and I think it was an introduction for both of them.
And by the time we did Beast, that was it, really. He'd become our sort of full-time producer and we didn't really think about using anyone else, and we used him for quite a few albums, basically, till he retired.
There was a certain excitement on Number of the Beast because we all felt... me especially, that there was something special about that album. Just the way it was coming together, the songs, the addition of Bruce, the extra scope that we had to work with. There was a certain feeling on that album that it was something special.
Basically, by the time we come to do the first couple of albums, we used all the material from that period, really, and some we'd written in that time. So the time we come to do Number of the Beast, we had no material left.
It was a fresh start writing-wise, and it was a different battery of songwriters.
You know, you take a rough idea in. That's a great thing about being in a band, and it from your sort of a seed of an idea, it becomes this big-sounding track, you know. That's one of the thrills for me of doing it, you know, and actually get in the studio and record it properly.
One guy picks up a guitar, somebody else clocks it and goes, oh, that's good, hang on a minute. So you've already got two or three different spins on ideas going on. Steve likes to go off and do all of his stuff on his own and plan it all out. I tend to be a bit more throw stuff at the wall.
If I'm writing a song and if it's just got my name on it, then usually I've written everything, you know, except for the guitar solos. And I just take it to the rest of the lads and show them the parts and just sort of layer it up like that. I don't usually do demos and stuff.
Some of the simpler songs, you know, they're written in 5 minutes, literally. I mean, the song is only probably about 5 minutes, but... I mean, it sounds a strange thing to say, but they were written quite quickly. And sometimes some of the best or catchiest songs are written like that. Some of them do work like that, and other ones you have to work on and takes time, you know, especially some of the longer ones, obviously.
Doing the album, OK, it's called Number of the Beast and that. You go in there and you don't think there's any acts like Full Suits. You're in there doing an album. And I think a lot of the stuff breaking down was technical stuff and things that happen anyway in the studio, things are going to go wrong, you know.
We all loved to ham it up as well, a little bit, you know, because we all thought it was a good laugh and we all thought it was a couple of good wind-ups going on there. The Martin Birch issue about the carload full of nuns is true.
On that Sunday, we were working on the track, Number of the Beast. It was a rainy night. I hit this van. I look in the back of the van, it's got windows, and it's got about half a dozen nuns in the back. Well, I think that's a bit unusual. You know. Sunday, whatever. So we get the van back, and it's raining. I'm in the middle of the road, and this guy starts praying to me.
He was very badly hurt. He was lucky not to be killed.
Anyway, I think the next day or a couple of days later, I took my Range Rover in to be repaired. So when I went to get the car, they gave me the bill, and it was £666.
Derek did a fantastic job. He made it very boshy and in a way with the small figures. He brought it in as the cover for Purgatory, and we looked at it and thought, that's much too good. We'll keep that for the next album. First thing you might want to note, if you can see this well, is the colours. This is actually a dark and a grey sky. The album, when it came out, was a blue sky and a light blue sky, and basically looked crap, because EMI managed the factory to complete screw up the printing process.
I suppose the idea is, you know, if you thought the devil was bad, you know, he's not as bad as Eddie, you know.
Who's manipulating who? That is the question.
And then when we've got the songs for the album, we looked at the song titles, and of course, you know, Number of the Beast obviously is perfect for that artwork.
Well, Eddie can be whatever you want him to be. That's the good thing about it, and that's one of the reasons why we've always had him on the covers. It means we ain't got to be on there at the start.
And it's great. It kind of takes away, you know, it puts most of the stuff on him, the weight on his shoulders, I feel like, you know. So that way we can go out shopping in Sainsbury's and nobody hassles us, you know.
And it means that, you know, you can do so much with him. He can do all the things that we don't want to do. You know, I wish he could do interviews, though, but you know, one day, you never know.
As we were putting the finishing touches to it, definitely we thought, yeah, this is going to be good.
It sounded completely new. People had never really heard anything like it before. Joining together something that was really melodic with something that was really like, ah!
When the Maiden video would come on, it would be like, all right, you know, and sit up and kind of, you know, readjust your ball sack and everything, and you're ready for some great music.
White man came across the sea.
Video was a great video, very humorous.
It's just basically about the Indian nations being, you know, sort of treated badly and taken over, really. But it's supposed to be from both sides. It's supposed to, you know, you've got the first part is as if in through the eyes of the Indian, and then the second part is as if through the eye of the cavalry soldier.
Gives you that kind of rolling feel, that galloping feel. And you put the guitars in on that.
Steve Harris's right hand like this the whole time. It's all an illusion, I think.
Run to the Hills, which is effectively a political song, which they've never really done before. So Steve was prepared to be a little bit more adventurous and perhaps in a way move away from the darker side in some respect and try something a little different.
I wouldn't say any of our tracks are really that political, really. They're not necessarily meant to be.
And I don't think they would have understood that political nuance anyway. Not in this country. Yeah, they're looking for sex, drugs and rock and roll in the lyrics. Not that.